house church, and then that's on a Monday. And then Tuesday, he's going to be with us for instead of Bible study. So he's going to be teaching on some things there. So I'm pretty excited about that. But it's not like a big full-blown conference, but it'll still be pretty amazing. Abner always brings some amazing words and oftentimes releases some amazing prophecies too. So look forward to hearing what the Lord's saying. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you. We're going to release the children, both the 0 to 2 and the 3 to 5 only this week as well. So we have to thank you, Jesus. Yes, ma'am. There isn't. Okay, I didn't know that. So thank you for letting me know that. There is no house church tomorrow at Darlene and Roy's. They are preparing for a journey to Moravian Falls. And why don't you guys pray that we have some incredible encounters with the Lord. If you don't know much about Moravian Falls, that's where Rick Joyner wrote The Final Quest in two encounters. Two encounters with the Lord and through this this vision that the Lord gave him. So it was a pretty powerful time. So we're just going to rest on the mountain of the Lord, the Moravian Falls Mountain, and go it over to Prayer Mountain and pray for a while. And so it's just a purely get away with the Lord and some people that could make it. If you didn't know about it, that's what happens when you when you work a lot. My wife was so excited. She said, look, you're starting the day we get back from Prayer Mountain, so you get to go with me. So I was like, all right, perfect. The hand of the Lord. So we're gonna pray, and then we're gonna just step into the Word of God. And I pray that your hearts are wide open for what God wants to speak, because before I say that, inquiring minds did want to know, where's Tracy? My wife did have a little bit of a rough night last night, but she was up and at 'em by the time I left. But obviously, she's getting herself together. So thanks. If you want to pray for her, that's great. She just was having some tough time sleeping and have a tough time getting to sleep. So I know Tammy helped pray with her last night, so that was awesome. Good to have friends in the trenches, right? And you guys are our friends in the trenches of life. But more importantly, like, the trenches only lead to victories. We don't sit in the trenches in vain. Some of you guys, I feel like the Lord just wants to say that like, warfare mentality is only warfare as long as you need it to be, if you'll get out of the trench and go face the giant. David came on the scenes, and it had been weeks of sitting there listening to Goliath taunt them. It's cool to be in the trenches, but trenches are for strategy. They're not your new home. Trenches are for strategy. They're not your new home. In Jesus, you're not supposed to be like, hey, look at this great trench. Oh, I'm a warfare person. I'm just going to war the rest of my life. Warfare is for strategy. Intercessors are supposed to be strategic. They're supposed to go into places, and they're supposed to unlock strategy from heaven and then come into earth and destroy the enemy. If we're not destroying the enemy and we're still in a trench, then that means you need to start praying for David to come. Right? If you're not going to face the giant, then pray for somebody that will in your life. Pray for somebody to come into your life that's going to face the giant for you. Now, I can't say that the Lord will always do that for you, but the Lord is very gracious. He will train you. He will train you. He will train you. But the main thing is that you want your prayers to get to heaven. So today we're going to be talking about a specific topic that I've been challenged with the Lord this week as I was seeking him. And so we just release, Lord, Holy Spirit, just come, inhabit this place, inhabit every heart, every mind. We thank you, Lord, they're all subject to you. And we just ask, Lord, no matter where they're at, they're going to come in alignment to your word right now. We just thank you, Father, that you are such a perfect God. You're such a loving God in all your ways, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you will be lifted up today. I pray my words wouldn't be mine, but yours alone, that they would speak to every heart, Lord, no matter where they're at, that they would pierce way beyond the soulish realm into the depths of who they are, so that the seed of God would live and not die, that they would each declare the work of the Lord, his goodness in the land of the living. We thank you, Father, that this is a special time that should be honored by all. So we pray for peace to reign right now in the name of Jesus. We just come against everything that would try to distract you, everything that would try to hinder you, everything that would keep you bound right now in the name of Jesus. We loose that and we release peace right now, that you would hear the word of your Father and your God, and that you would be able to hearken unto his voice, that you would be able to come in alignment, that you would be able to rise up and take your place in his house. And we just give you thanks, Lord, for all that. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I'm pretty fired up. I had a very relaxing couple days, and it was very refreshing. Got to spend some time in prayer and just in the Word, and then hang out with some of the elders that were able to make it, and just it was good. It was good to actually feel like I could be a pastor one day. As opposed to bivocational, they're both great. I love whatever situation I'm in. I give thanks always, because it's so amazing when you give thanks, the difference in your perspective. So, redemption. I'm gonna tell you two things that Dan said last week, and these are pretty much not Dan. These are definitions for two different words. Redemption means to be brought back to the original value, or purchased back, but not just purchased, but purchased back because there's a value. There's a value. You don't pay nothing for junk. Most people live in a world where they're the junk, and God had to come and save the junk. But that's not at all true. God came to purchase you with a high price so you would see your real value. Okay? He purchased redemption to buy back for real value. You have great value, and that great value should be aligned with his great price he paid. Redemption, right? Okay, this is Redemption House. We want to redeem all those that come into the house of God for their value, not for what they can do for us, but what God sees them for. And when we can raise them up and what God sees them for, then they can be raised up to what he says about them. It's time, you know, we can't go like, well, is this a good one? Oh, what are you doing sitting on the front row? You're not a charter member? Yeah, I read that scripture, those scriptures where Jesus talks about priority, preference, preferring people. It's a really scary chapter, because when we prefer people because of what they can do for us, the door they could open for us, that what they could be for us, then what happens in our hearts is we become hardened to the voice of God and alive to the reality of people in our life. And so I feel like the Lord, if there's anybody that struggles in that area, make sure that people don't rule you. People don't own you. People don't get to make your decisions for you, but you seek the Lord always, right? All right, next one. This one's important. Justification. What's justification mean? Just as if I never sinned. That's a really important one. So justification, just as if I never sinned, is a really big deal. If I never sinned, what would life look like? If no one ever sinned against me, what would it look like? See, a lot of times we can grab a hold of, like, I've been justified, but the beauty is, so is everyone else in his sight. Can they be in your sight? The reason why we hold on to our past is because it's filled of people that have hurt us instead of people we've let go and let be justified in our eyes. Just as if they never happened. Just as if it never happened, just as if bad things never happened to good people, just as if nothing ever bad happened to me, that I gave authority to start shaping my life, okay? Not only have I been justified that I've never done anything, but also nothing's ever been done. It's very important, both directions. The reason why we forgive is not always for the other person, even though that's important, right? Because whoever sins, you forgive, they're forgiven. This is a high order from God. If you hold on to people's sins, they're held on to. That's a problem because you're responsible to answer to God why you're holding sins in your hand. Well, this guy, he didn't deserve forgiveness. Look what he did. This is way beyond what you would forgive. Right? So here it is. God doesn't, if God forgives it, it shouldn't be in your hand either. All right? So justification. So now we covered both those. Those were really easy, and you guys got them quick. So we're going to turn to Romans 8. We'll kick this off. Romans 8. What a juicy scripture. Romans 8. If I had one chapter in the Bible, it might be Romans 8. It's like so phenomenal. Juicy fruit. I'm even going to start with some people's best memorized verse, just because I think one of the greatest things that you should do is figure out what your favorite verse says in context. Wouldn't that be nice? Like if you didn't just memorize the part you liked, but you memorized the whole truth, that you memorized the whole word, that you looked around and said, hey, it says more than just that. So here you go. Romans 8:28. Some people can quote it, I'm sure. Here it goes. And we know that all things are working together for our good. All things are working together for the good to them that love God and to them that are called according to his purpose. Okay, let's start right there. Most people only have part A memorized. And we know that all things are working together for the good to them that love God. Not all things are working together for the good. That's what we usually quote, right? All things work together for the good. And we're like, period. No, not period. It doesn't say period. It doesn't say everything's going to work together for your good. It does not say that. It says all things work together for the good of those who love God. It says that. That's like the rest of it. Memorize the rest because the rest is really important. And that love doesn't say who kind of love God, who like him, who say nice things about him. It says literally those who agape the Lord. I made sure that I checked it out for you. Those who agape the Lord. Now, agape calls us a little higher than the normal, like, I really kind of like God. Hey, I go to church. No. Agape, if you guys, I don't want to get into a big dissertation of love, but the reality is the love of God is the same love he's requiring of you for all things to work together for your good. That's scary. He's saying, I believe that I've given enough love into your life that you can come up higher. I believe if you'll come up higher, then you'll see how all things are working together for your good. But you can't even see it because a lot of times you're going like, man, this stuff's not working together for my good because this is what I expect because I love myself still too much. It's the loving of ourself. It's the loving of ourself that taints our love for God, which makes us not see how it's working together. God's trying to put things in order in our life, but he's starting with our hearts, right? He's starting with our very love. Like, how much can you love me? And as I say, I gave you grace to take you there, right? I want you all to always realize that it's grace that takes us into agape. It's his perfect grace because all you have to be able to do, if you say, Lord, I don't have wisdom, it says, let any man who lacks wisdom ask of God, he'll give liberally and abradeth not. He gives a lot and he never holds back. That's a good promise. Well, if he does it for wisdom, I bet you he does it for love. If he does it for love, I bet you he does it for faith. So all we have to actually do is realize that I have need of Holy Spirit to add to me who I am. So all things work together for the good to the, hold on, all things work together for the good to them that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. So the next part is the calling according to his purpose. I can't park here real long, but the next part is the fact that you're focused on his calling, okay? Not your love. Not what God's doing in your life, but the call that's on your life. There's a calling upward that means I'm not trying to keep you here, and I may or may not be focused on what you're focused on. I have one focus, and that's my call on your life. My call on your life is the one that I'm going to fund. The call that's on your life is the one that God's funding. His purpose is aligns with his provision. When you don't find provision, it's because we've got disjoint from purpose. I feel it sinking in. This is a slow roast. I can feel it. Come on. It's a slow roast. I feel like a little bit of hard ground, a little fallowness, but we just thank you, Lord, for just letting that word sink in. Because as we align to purpose, we also align to provision. When we align to the call of God on our life, we align to his provision, his providence. So all things work together for the good to them that love the Lord, but also those who are called according to his purpose. Verse 29, for whom he did foreknow, he also predestined, and to be conformed into the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. Moreover, whom he did predestine, to them he also called. And to them he called, he also justified. And whom he also justified, he also glorified. Now that last word gets most people real excited. The single fact is that God has called you to reign and be glorified in him. That's his goal, to reign and be glorified in him. But there's a process, not a process like you've got to work it out, but a process you've got to believe and step into so that that process can happen, right? And here is that process. Like, he foreknew you. He foreknew you. He knew who was coming to the wedding before he sent out the invitations. Some people wonder, like, why did you waste money on the stamps if you already foreknew who was going to come? Why did you make them walk it out? Why did you make them actually come? Why didn't you just say, well, I know they're going to come. Let's just keep them on the right, keep the other ones on the left, and pull the big hell trap door. They all go away. Some people wonder these things, right? You wonder, why in the world, if God already foreknows everything, and this is actually a big debate, because if God foreknows, then why should I even try? Because if you don't want to try, he already foreknew that. That's a problem. Let's start right there. If you don't care that he cares, if you don't care that he gave his son, if that doesn't stir up your heart for a life devoted, that he gave his only begotten son so that you would live, and you choose not to live for him, but you choose to live for yourself. You got to wonder, if God foreknows that, how does that make you feel? It ought to convict your heart to turn back to him. Because here's the thing, guys. Ultimately, God is calling us all higher. And he does foreknow us, but that doesn't give us access to the lazy boy. Like, let's just ride this thing out and do it my way. So he foreknew us. He also predestinated us to be conformed into the image of his son. So he says, those I know, I'm predestined to be in the image of my son. Sonship is yours if you believe that God knows that you're here today. God knows that you're pursuing him today, and God knows that he's going to take you in and mold you into the image of his son, make you like his son. In fact, he's already made you like his son. It's the reality of becoming yours. The reality of his sonship becoming your reality is one of the toughest things to convince people. Because if you're justified, it's like it never happened. But more importantly, what has never happened, you've never done wrong, that's great. But what's never happened to you, it says we were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. In other words, we were tutored by those that taught us, here's how life should be. This is how you should live it. This is how you respond. When people do you dirty, you get dirty back because you don't want them walking all over you. So you teach things like that. You're tutored in the world, and then that world system is now your new mentality. But you have to be renewed in the spirit of your mind into Christ Jesus, right? So as we're renewed in our mind, that's where justification comes. Like, they didn't know what they were teaching me was wrong. See, we have to stop blaming everyone, even what they did to us.
Because here's the thing, if they had ever known what they were doing wrong, they would have never done it. So when are we going to be the people to go back and say, you didn't know what you were doing wrong. I forgive you, for you know not what you do. Where is that spirit, even on the cross? I couldn't even imagine the pain of being on the cross. I've had bones broken, and I thought, this is the worst pain. Somebody else says, no, this is worse. Somebody else says, this is worse. All I can say is I couldn't even imagine the pain of being on a cross. And in the midst of all that pain, saying, forgive them. They know not what they do. I mean, being on a cross is about the time when you say, okay, take me home. I'm done. Quick. But hours and hours go by of pain and suffering for him to say this. Forgive them. They know not what they do. So here's the thing. If he's forgiven them because they didn't know what they do, can you forgive those who didn't know what they're doing? And if you can, then you're going to be in his image. And as the image of his son, if he's predestined you to be in the image of his son, he's also called you. And if he's called you, he's also justified you. And that's where justification happens. It's as if it never happened because you've been called and you've came out from among them. You've been called and you've come out from among them. You've been called and you've been come out from among them. It means you've been called, you listened, and you stepped out from the status quo Christianity. You stepped out from the ways of the world. You're not of the world, okay? This is, yeah, that's super important, because if we're not of the world, we're going to look different. The one thing I never wanted in my life was to look exactly the same as the rest of them. And here's the thing. Chris was just telling me about this. He said he would go places and he would witness to somebody, and then the next thing you know, they're telling you all the things you're doing wrong. Oh, none of y'all witnessed. I got Matt and Chris. All right, me, Matt, and Chris know that when you witness to people, it draws a line. It draws a line. And the funny thing is, you could be on their side drawing a line. And they're going to push you and say, why aren't you on your side of the line if you drew it? See, the first thing I try to do on my job is tell everybody around me I'm a Christian. You know why? Because I don't want them thinking I'm on their side of the line, and I don't want, if they see me, I want them to know, hey, you have the right to tell me where I'm in error, because I don't want you to think I'm like the world. If I draw the line early, guess what? They're not going to go, hey, you want to go to the club with me? They ain't going to say, you want to go to the bar with me? That's real common in the culture that I'm in, that you go to the bar, you buy them lots of drinks, and you try to get them to sign contracts, apparently. You try to win them over by buying them. And I say, like, yeah, I don't do that. I don't go to the bar. We can go to the food. We can do that stuff. I don't drink. Like, first thing, because you know why? Because people won't ask me to do things I don't do. And I won't be like, oh, I'm so tempted. I don't need to be tempted. You know why? Because I already drew a line. And if I had a drink in my hand one day, they would say, I thought you were a pastor. I thought you were a Christian. I thought you didn't drink. You know what? I wouldn't be tempted because I would have already drew the line. If they seen a cigarette in my hand one day, they'd be like, "What? I thought you were a pastor." Or I'm talking about when I was young, when I was a Christian, they would say, like, I thought you were a Christian. If I cussed on the job, I'm an electrician. I'm supposed to cuss. I'm a construction worker. As soon as I said I was a Christian, I mean like a week, 2 weeks into it. Hey, guys, I'm a Christian. I found Jesus. They were like, oh. As soon, they're like watching after that. They got out their magnifying glass. I'm like, man, I'm under the scope now. Every mistake I made, like that, constantly hammering me what I'm doing wrong. You know what was the best thing for me? That I drew the line. I can't say it was easy. It kind of stunk because I was like, oh, well, you. You know, you're like, do I justify myself right now in the image of the world, or do I respect what they're saying as that's what the world believes Jesus looks like? Here's the thing. The church believes Jesus, believes that the church believes that the church is allowed to look like the world, and the world believes the church should look like Jesus. Isn't that quite a paradox? The world will tell you, once you draw the line, that doesn't look like Jesus. They expect you to look like Jesus. You know why they expect you to look like Jesus? Because that's what they believe. What happened to the church? Isn't that, it got real quiet, like, shh. Yeah, it's good to think, isn't it? So here it is. If he justified us, to whom he justified, he glorified. And this is literally the Lord saying, I desire to crown you in the earth. Okay? To crown you in the earth. You know, one thing that's one of the greatest crowns we could ever have in the earth, one of the greatest crowns that any man could ever have in the earth is a smiling wife. It says it in Proverbs. It says it in Proverbs. One of my biggest desires is that my wife always looks like life is amazing for her. Because if people see that she enjoys the life that's been given and the husband that's been given, it's a crown to me. That's what it says in Proverbs. It's a crown to me because I've set an environment that she could flourish. And I can't say I do that all the time well. Oh, there she is. You made it, honey. Isn't she lovely? Oh, sorry. I had a moment. Sorry. She hates when I do that, and I don't mean to do it. It just comes out. No, I really didn't mean to do it. It just comes out. I'm serious. Okay, so let's get back on track. So how would I think, if things never were wrong in my life, how would I think if I was tutored by heaven instead of tutored by this world? What this exercise is to do is to make you think, what would happen if all the things that you did wrong and everything that was done wrong to you, if that was completely erased from your life? What would happen? What would you be like today if none of that ever happened? And I just need you to get there with me for a second. And some of you guys, I know it's going to be a harder mental block because it's going to be hard to even think through the traumas. But here's the thing. I want you to just imagine a world, a life, whatever age you are today, where you've never done anything wrong and nothing has ever been done wrong to you. Now, that's pretty good. That's pretty amazing. Next step. How would I live if I had anything and everything I needed? Y'all are like, pastors going into fairy tales. Here's the key. Jesus never let sin against him produce sin in him. He never let sin against him produce sin in him. What was done to him never was done in him. Most of us are carrying the weight of the sin against us instead of releasing it and constantly like it never happened. You didn't. That didn't happen to me. That happened in you. It didn't faze me. It didn't hurt me. It didn't cause me to be different. It didn't cause me to see you different. It caused me to see you as a hurting individual that needs an example, needs a savior in Jesus' case. But in our case, you need an example of what a son looks like. Christians, we can't keep holding Christians to expectations when they haven't had good models. I think it's sad that even though I just slammed the church a second ago, I'm desperately in love with the bride, but my love for the bride doesn't say like, she's bad and the world says she should be this way and we're not that way. No. It compels me to model Christ. It compels me to model Christ. What does his love look like? How far will he go? What will he do for others? You know, and that compelling
is what I'm trying to get you guys to right now. So he wants to glorify us in such a way that everything that we have need of, his hand has provided, right? He has provided. Because he foreknew us, he already ordained our steps, ordered our steps. He already caused us everywhere we go to know that that's going to be available when you get there. Now, that's a different life to live. And I know it might sound like a little bit off. It might sound a little crazy. But here's what I want to get everyone in the room to. It's available. It's available right now that you can live a life where you said the past is smashed. Everything about it, the good, the bad, and the ugly. I love Paul saying, like, I forget the things behind me. And he forgets them because rather they're good, you can start hanging trophies. And then you hang on your goodness. You hang on what you've done. You hang on your accomplishments. And you're like, I was first place. And next thing you know, you're Al Bundy. Sorry if you're young. You don't even know what I'm talking about. But you're the guy who thinks, like, I used to be amazing. I was a, you know, World Cup. I was the best on the football team. It doesn't matter what you were. What are you now? What does what you were have to do with what you are now? Because here's what. I could have been the most amazing, on-fire Christian 10 years ago. And today, I don't even connect with God. Even if I come to church, I'd come to church because I feel like I got to do that because I have it ingrained in me. But the reality is I'm here to provoke you that there's so much more of, I just take the lid off of your world and say there's so much more in Christ. There's so much more available. Jesus lived such a crazy life. He's like, nothing, I'm not going to let anything in. I'm not going to let anything hurt me. And then he said this. Oh, no, what are we going to do about these taxes? Oh, no, that was Peter, right? It wasn't Jesus. Peter's like, oh, man, what are we going to do about these taxes? Ah, and Jesus is like, well, Father, because you don't come up with these things on your own. Father, come on, give him a doozy. Give him a doozy. He goes, okay, you're going to throw a hook into the sea. You're going to reel it in. The first fish you catch, you're going to open his mouth and get the money out of his mouth. And that alone, that coin alone. I don't know how much your taxes are, but just like taxes go like $10,000, $20,000, $30,000 in the fish's mouth. Thank you very much. Oh, it was enough for two people's taxes. One coin, tax money. Jesus didn't have like an escrow in his taxes where he went to the tax man at the end and April 15th was coming and he was like, oh my gosh, I hope I put enough into taxes. Oh no, let's get a coin. Oh, he gave me an extra 50 cents. I got it. No. He put nothing in and it was tax time for the big tax. He was 1099, Jesus. Jesus was straight up 1099. So he had the big tax, and it all fit right in the fish's mouth. It's pretty amazing, right? Here you go. Now, the reason why I'm saying this is because many of us are challenged by the limitations of where we are, and we say, I can't do what God's called me because I don't have what I need. And God said, if you did what I called you to, you'd have everything you need. Transform your mind right now. Hear the word of the Lord. He's saying, as you conform to my will, as you conform to what I've called you to, I have provision. Jesus said, I have meat you know not of. I have plenty. I don't know what source you're tapped into, but the source I have has more than enough. You know, he has the cattle on 1,000 hills. He has more than we can imagine. And the more I trust, the more he does so many amazing things. And sometimes I was like, I don't know if God can do that. I remember the last job I got, I was like, that is by far the most you could ever do. And then he did this job. I'm like, that is incredible.
I cannot believe what God can do as we continue to trust him, to trust him, to trust him. You can't know him until you trust him. You can't know him until you test him. And he said, test me in this, right? He loves us to step out. Because even if we were to test him in error, he would say, no, 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 that's not how you test me. But he's clear to say, test me in this. One of them is in our giving. That's just one of them. I mean, we need to test the Lord, because when we step out and we go and we do and we believe and we sow, and God can come through because we're stepping out of the boat. So I was thinking about this, right, because it's just been brewing in me. If I had everything I need, you know, pray. How would we pray if the Lord was listening? Like, I know we believe the Lord's listening, but if you asked for stuff that God wasn't giving you and you knew he was listening, wouldn't you assume that he wants to give you something different? Maybe, no. He might want you to have it, but he might not want you to have it now. So your prayer life consists of what you want now instead of what God wants you to have now. And if you get what God wants you to have first, like the kingdom of heaven, if you seek first the kingdom of heaven, if you start praying for a seeking heart, Father, I want a seeking heart after the kingdom of heaven. I can guarantee this, then all other things will be added to you. If you pray for a seeking heart, then he can give you a seeking heart. And after you have a seeking heart, then he can give you all other things. So we have to prioritize what we're seeking after. And if we prioritize our seeking, then we know everything's going to be given, because Jesus was clear. Ask, seek, and knock, right? Ask, it'll be given to you. Knock, the door will be open. Seek, and you get to find. That's great news. But some people's experiences, well, sometimes God doesn't answer prayer. No, God's always listening. He's always concerned. He always cares. But he also knows some things are not good timing. Like, take advantage of your time that you have. Take advantage of where you are. Every season of your life should be maximized. If you can maximize your season, then God can bring you into another season. If you maximize your single season, he can flourish you in your marriage season. Most people are so excited about wanting to be married, they never even take time to think of what a good single season looks like. What should I be as a single? What should I be when I'm alone? You're never alone. You're never alone. You're never alone. You cannot be alone, ever. And when you think you can be alone, somebody else can leave you alone. And then you could be hurt. Then you could be totally destroyed, because how could you leave me alone? This is what everybody else has done to me. And you become broken, because you never were whole in your single season. And we could do that all day long, seasons and seasons, and not maximizing your season. You know, I learned to tithe when I made $650, probably $625, I think it was first. I got a quarter raise. It was big time. $625 was my money, my big money. And I made less than that in my life when I was doing burgers. I worked at McDonald's. I worked at Hardee's. I did all the jobs. I was working somewhere, and somebody said fast food and construction. Everybody should do that. Both those jobs in their life, just to teach them what life's about. You know, first of all, do some table waiting or some customer service, like right there when everybody's like really hungry and they want you to give them food. No. So I learned in that season of 625 to say, man, how can I give God money when I only make $625? It doesn't make sense to give God money when I make $625. Somebody else in the church should do it. Then I start asking people that weren't in the church, because I knew the church was in cahoots for my $625 money. I knew the church was totally in cahoots, like, because I see them giving, and I don't know what they're doing, but I thought a dollar was good, and then somebody else had bigger money in there, and I was like, what is wrong with them? Like, they could do some big stuff with that money. And so I go to some people that aren't in cahoots with my church, and I ask this guy on the job, and I was like, you said you're a Christian? You seem pretty hardcore. I like that. I like, because I would blast my Jesus freak, DC Talk, I'll be jamming it and doing electric work, and I would be working in this house. And then this one guy came, I would go to this one job, and this guy comes in, he's like, oh, you're a Christian. And he was really hardcore too, so I was like, I trust this guy. I like this guy. He knows the Bible really good. And so we instantly became friends. And so I talked to him, and I said, man, I found out these guys at church, they were talking about this thing. I was like, I don't know. They said they were given 10% of their income. And I was like, dude, that's crazy, ain't it? He's like, nah, you're supposed to. And I was like, you too. It was like, I had to learn to maximize that season of my life, because if you can't give it $6.25, you certainly can't give it $50 an hour income. How do you expect for more to be given when you're unfaithful with what's been given? It's a real simple concept. And so a lot of times we're praying for the next season to come when we haven't done what's required in this season. And all we have to do is like turn the key of that season, the door goes open. We actually do not have to live in the time of the season. Listen carefully. This is actually where this message is going. You do not have to live according to the time schedule of the season. You're actually so supernatural that when you get the point of the season, you can move to the next season. This is how the reapers learn to overtake the sowers. You can start harvesting in ground that has not even been sown in, because you know how to access heaven. You know how to maximize your season, and it's not about you doing enough time. You don't have to do time. This isn't jail sentence here on earth, okay? This is time you get to learn, because you actually say, God, what would you want me to do in this season? What would you want me to learn in this season? And God downloads it to you. God gives it to you, and you step into it, and you move forward in it. Amen? Amen. So in every season, if you learn the season, you can move through the season at a rapid, accelerated pace. And as you gain momentum, as you gain understanding, as you gain the ability to see the Spirit of the Lord and see the Spirit moving in the earth, you can begin to walk from glory to glory, from faith to faith at a much more accelerated rate, because you know quickly, turn your eyes to heaven. What's God saying? What's Jesus want? Holy Spirit, what are you doing? And you start looking for him. You start looking for God in these things. And it becomes so amazing. It becomes an adventure instead of like a paying your dues and serving your sentence. Like, I'm serving this sentence as a single. One day I'm not going to be single anymore. Well, I just hope that poor person that you're going to get married to is really prayed up. Because they're going to be saying, forgive them. They don't know what they do. They're going to be saying, Father, why hast thou forsaken me? Because they married somebody who didn't maximize their single season. Woman down on front row. All right. So here you go. How many people in here have never heard of a woman named Heidi Baker? Okay, let me do it the other way, because they're going to be non-participators. She preaches a message on God activating participators in the last days instead of spectators. God don't like them taters. He likes participators. He likes participators. If you don't participate, you actually get no reward. Anyway, so Heidi, who heard of Heidi Baker? Okay, so it's a lot of you? Okay, good. So the people that raised their hand, the other people I'm assuming were the not hearers. So they're going to be working on their participating gift in Jesus' name. So Heidi Baker's amazing woman of God. She's probably well over 10,000 churches under her and Roland Baker Iris Ministries. And she's a phenomenal woman of God, but here's one of the things she teaches about. She teaches about this. If you love the one,
then you can love the one in front of you. If you love, it's a message she teaches. It's called Love the One. If you love this one well, then no matter who God brings to you, you can love. Rather, they're going to cut your throat, you can love them with a perfect love, because perfect love's been shown. Most of us aren't letting perfect love be shown. The intimacy's not there in our relationship with God, the prayer life, the Him wooing us and taking us into His secret places and into His chambers and causing us to be pregnant with His purpose. Okay, so we end up walking around with our purpose and we put Jesus' name on it. And it just doesn't work, guys. We get alone with Him, intimate with Him, in the chambers with Him, and we become pregnant with His purpose. And this love that He shows to us is the only way we get that love. It's the grace. We ask for love, sure, but eventually you know where to get it. You know where to get it. There's only one place to get it. Go and buy wine. Go and buy oil for yourself. You need to get your own lantern filled. I can't give you my intimacy. I can't give you the oil in my lamp. I can only tell you who has all the oil. And if you go to Him, you won't be having all these surface level problems, because you can love the one in front of you no matter who they are. So she talks about all kinds of crazy things about loving the one, rather it was the kid of the pastor who got chopped up into pieces and sent over to them, and he gets mail. He opens the mail. It's his son in a box. He has a burial service and goes to visit the people a few days away. He gets there and he says, "You killed my son. I want them out of jail." And they thought, what's he going to do? He's probably going to kill them. And he says, no, I want them out of jail because they don't know what they do. They don't understand that you can cut off our hands and more will come giving. You can cut off our feet and more will come to tell you about His good news. You can cut off our tongues and we'll still continue to come and tell you about Jesus and His love for you and how He's forgiven you. And she's going through this, and this stuff wrecks your mind. You hear about people that have actually had real traumas. Like, it's one thing for your kid to die in a car accident for a drunk driver. They don't know what they're doing. How can you respond to that is a different question. Like, the main thing that's needed at this time is them to understand that there's a love that is beyond what's happened to us. There is a love beyond what's been done to us. There is a love far beyond anything in this world could ever offer. And if we don't arise and shine, then no one will ever know what is even in us. And so this that's in us needs to be given to this world. And if you're in here and you're like, I don't know what you're talking about, you need to get plugged into somebody else that does. You need to stop sitting in the, like I did for months, going like, is this stuff real? I'm trying to figure it all out on my own. Look, you can spend a lot of time figuring it all out on your own, or you can plug in to someone that's already figured it out and just climb up on their shoulders and dive a new place for you. We want to be a church that enables people to go further than us. But we can't do that if you're like, well, I got to figure it out on my own. It's like, you can. It just doesn't, it's not conducive to inheritance. And inheritance is that I earned this much, and I want you to have it all so that you can have double. And if you look at how God does things, He likes to double and then double again and then double again, even in cellular multiplication. Everywhere if you look at the Lord, He always is duplicating. His favorite way to multiply is to duplicate. He likes taking two and having another and then having another, and then they're splitting and they're filling the earth with His glory. So I challenge you guys, if you're a spiritual father or mother, look around. Get an idea who needs a hand up, and let's begin to be that for them. So, loving the ones, it's amazing. So, if we imagine
consistently living in the moment. Consistently living in the moment. I was going to read the story of the woman caught in adultery. I'll just paraphrase it. But if you're taking notes, it's John 8, verse 1. This woman was caught in adultery. They threw her on the ground. And they said, what are you going to do with this woman caught in adultery? And in their minds, they're already plotting on how Jesus is probably going to foil it. He's going to mess it up because he's going to try to be nice to this lady. And he's going to be out of the law. And he's going to be guilty of sin himself. So he sees them trying to trap him. He knows what the law says. She should be stoned. They got stones ready to throw. They're ready to kill her because she should be killed according to the law. Okay? Again, Jesus came to fulfill the law, not do away with it. So this is important because we're living in a day where sexual immorality seems to be okay. And it's still, guess what? Sin. It's still not okay. It's still not okay at all. Heterosexual or homosexual. It's not okay if you're not married. Imagine that God doesn't change. That doesn't always mean he's always good to me. It means he always doesn't change, always, every way. Okay? I have to say these things because I know people like to run with these things. I'm much more interested in you running after God than I am, because really the only way we'll stop falling in love with our sin is to fall in love with something greater. And so I don't really want to crush things that you think you love. I want to show you something that's better love. Right? It's really cool to say, like, don't do this and don't do that and don't do this. Like, if you don't know why you're even doing it, people use drugs because they're numbing their pain. They don't even know they don't need the pain anymore. They don't even know the pain's already been removed. They can't even get it because they haven't even, like, looked into his face long enough. If we can show them something better, we can stop judging them for their addiction. If we look at their condition and see that they don't know who they are, they don't know who they are, so therefore, instead of condemnation, we can show an answer. The answer is that Jesus is more beautiful than anything you could ever live for. Even beyond Jesus, believe it or not, if the church had a paradigm beyond Jesus, Jesus said the kingdom of heaven, I found the kingdom of heaven and I sold everything I have that I could buy this pearl of great price, right? So there's this concept that if you see the kingdom of heaven, you're going to sell everything you have and you're going to follow Jesus. Now, you're not following Jesus because Jesus is the only answer. There's a much, Jesus is a taste of what heaven looks like. But you manifesting Jesus, manifesting love in the earth, is going to show the earth what love looks like through you. You're not going to look exactly like Jesus. You're going to look like you, with wrapped up in love. And it's going to be completely unique. It's going to be completely amazing. So the woman's thrown at their feet. They're all having rocks. They're all trying to catch Jesus to make a mistake. And right when Jesus says it, he just goes down, writes on the dirt. And there's lots of revelations in this. But here's what he says. Let you that's without sin cast the first stone. So some people believe Jesus was kind of writing down what other people have done that were in the crowd. Oh, look, the chief Pharisee over there. I remember that, like, just yesterday. I don't know what he was writing, okay? We could speculate. I'm not big into speculation with the word of God, but here, because it's not, if it was important, he would have told us. What's most important is Jesus wrote what you need written on that dirt. That's what Jesus wrote on the dirt. Whatever it would take for you to follow him is what he wrote. Whatever you need written is written. So if somebody, if some preacher needed him to write sins down, cool, he wrote sins down. But whatever he wrote, maybe he wrote great. Maybe he wrote love and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. Maybe you need more love. Maybe you need more mercy. Maybe you need something different. But whatever you need, it is written. Everything you need, his hands have provided. So he says, let him that's without sin cast the first stone.
Let him that's without sin cast the first stone. And it says from the oldest to the youngest, they begin to drop their rocks and walk off. They begin to drop their rocks and walk off because they started seeing, oh my gosh, I'm convicted in the sight of my own sin. I see my own sin for what it is. And he drops his rocks and they begin to walk away. And he says, woman, where are your accusers? Or where are those who condemn you to death? And she says, she looks up after bawling her eyes out, thinking she's ready to die. She looks around and she says, I don't see any. And Jesus says, I condemn you neither. Which literally is Jesus saying, who cast the first stone? He's saying, I am not going to condemn you either, even though I have no sin. Even someone without sin should be the first to forgive, not the one to think they're the most holy. The better you're living for God should be the better you're loving for God. Your love should be the motivation for all holiness, or your holiness is out of control. I love holiness. I desire holiness. I love holiness because holiness is what's getting me to where God wants me to be. When I go off onto my own direction, I'm short-circuiting every plan that God has for me. Selfishness is the worst way to live because ultimately God didn't make me for myself, and it kills everything that God has planned for me. So you have to learn to hate sin. Hate it like it's your enemy. Hate it like it's cancer. Hate it like you could get rid of it and it's cancer in your body. You could just take it and say, like, no more. I don't want this cancer. Like, if you start seeing the destructive nature of sin in your life, you'll start saying, I do not want it. I hate this. And as you start to hate it long enough, you'll start figuring out what to do to stay away from it. I could go further, but the most important thing is that you start figuring out how you can stay so far from it that it can't even get to a place where it lodges itself into your mind, where it has the ability to grab a hold of you. You just stay so far away from it that you don't, like my wife and I don't go into bars, never. Like, we wouldn't say like, oh, you know, we're good now. We've been 20 years clean. It doesn't matter. We don't want to be a near addiction because addiction is I don't even want to struggle with that. If God told me to go in, sure, that's no problem. But God isn't saying, hey, go into this bar. Let's see how close you can get to the edge. Last time I heard about a David that got close to the edge, it was no bueno. You know? He saw Bathsheba, and it was just no bueno. So you stay away from the edges, and you stay in the center of God's will. A lot of us are like, can I get this far, and God still loves me? How about this far? Will God still love me this far? No, stop. That desire to see how close you can get to the edge, you're already down the slide. You just haven't felt it yet. When you start getting close to the edge, you're already down the slide. So this woman caught in adultery, as she gets up and she realizes that she's not been condemned by the Lord, he says, go and... Really important line here that I think we don't preach enough about. Jesus forgives the lady of the adultery and gives her another life to live. Jesus has given us another life to live. And he said to the woman, go. Okay, we're going to try it again. Did you hear what your neighbor said? Because maybe you don't know the scriptures, but if you can hear what other people are saying, this is really important. Jesus forgives the woman who's caught in adultery, who deserves to die according to the law, and not only deserves to die, but they have the rocks to kill her. And minutes later, she's forgiven by Jesus, and Jesus says, go and sin no more. Literally, go, sin, no more. None. Jesus didn't go, well, you know, you've kind of been in adultery all your life. I get it. It's going to take a process. Go and get 3 sozos. He didn't say, go and get into prayer. Because you've been forgiven,
go and sin no more. When you believe that's possible, you'll be able to do it. As long as you say, that's impossible. Of course it is to you. As long as you believe you living right for God is impossible, it will be. I'm opening up myself to all possibilities these days. All things are possible to them that believe. Will you stand on your feet with me? I'm going to close with this because I want to get your prayer wheels turning this week.
Debbie, if you can come up here for a minute, please. I'm going to have Debbie share a testimony with everybody. It's not going to be long, but it's going to be to a point. And I feel like people need to hear it because what she's going to share is real. And all of us have a situation that is similar. But as I'm sitting back there, we're talking about the amazing love. And we're talking about receiving his love. And I hear the Lord saying that some of you do not even truly believe that you have been forgiven. And the reason you're being blocked in that amazing love is because you do not really, really, really believe that you've been forgiven. And it's so heavy on my heart right now. And I don't care if it's just for one person in this room or if it's for more than one person in this room. You cannot leave here today not knowing how forgiven you really are and what he's done for you. Because in that is how you receive perfect love. In that is how you learn to give perfect love. When that great news comes and you receive that forgiveness, you will be totally changed, completely, radically wrecked.
Pastor was talking about God's love, and I have struggled with relationships with my siblings, and it's been, this year has been really, really hard for me, and one of my sisters had done something, and it just really blew my mind. I figured they're, you know, I'm not going to have a relationship with them. They don't love me. They don't really care about me. And I carried a, it was hard. We didn't have a relationship. They have no idea what's going on in me. I'm struggling spiritually, and I want to be more Christ-like. I want God to be more resonant in my life. How can I do this with my siblings when all I see is just turmoil and unforgiveness and just bitterness rising up? And I don't know on their part, but I know on my part, this is what's happening in my life. And I didn't want it anymore. And God just showed me, and I said, God, I want more of you. What do I do? And God just says, when you look at her, you're looking at me. And when you hold her, you have to give up all of that you feel and remember it no more. Now, that's hard, but I said, God, that's what I want to do. I'm going to see my family next week, but I'm already free. And when I'm already free because I love God, and I love him more than the things of this world, and I want to be more Christ-like. And I said, God, that's what I want. I'm free. I feel so, I don't know if you understand that. I'm just free. When I look at her, I'm not going to look at what I felt she's done to me. I'm not going to look at anything but that I love her, God loves her, and all this other stuff is just in the wind because it doesn't mean anything in the light of eternity.
So Debbie doesn't know that yesterday, like this last 2 weeks, the Lord's been telling me to forgive my sister. And I thought I have, right? Healing comes in different levels. So I thought I'd forgiven her. So I saw her at Walmart yesterday. But she walked right by me and didn't even recognize me. And I couldn't move. I forgave her. When I saw her, I know I forgave her. Because I've been forgiven. And I've received that love. So it is easy when you receive that to be able to forgive. And Dan said one thing that he said. The verse says that we hold on to our present and our future. It didn't say anything about the past. So we forget the past. Those things that try to come and attack you and haunt you, they have no place over God's forgiveness, his good news, and over his love. They have no place. Do you hear me? People that are still walking under that false voice, it has no place in your life. So I knew I forgave her when I saw her yesterday. I knew there was nothing there. So I'm going to go see her tomorrow morning. She doesn't know I'm coming, but you all can keep me in prayer because her definition of me right now is I'm the devil. So it's been that definition for about 15 years. Ever since I got out of the Catholic religion and became a Christian. But nothing have I ever shown her is devilish. And she knows that in her heart. So I believe God's lining up this encounter. So Debbie, when you were sharing that, it was just like speaking to me too, because I know I need to go. When you said, when you just wrap your arms around her, she's going to feel nothing but that great love. That's what's going to happen tomorrow morning when I go over there. So I just thank the Lord for that. And the Lord said that she didn't recognize me yesterday because I don't look the same. I'm not even going to look the same in her eyes. That's why she didn't recognize me. So what the Lord was saying, what I felt, I heard the Lord saying, let me say that, is that I felt like some of you really need to receive the forgiveness that Jesus actually paid for you. There was a part of this service that was a deliverance part of the service as Pastor David was speaking. And what that part was maxing the season that you're in. And the reason you're not moving to the next season is because this season has not been maximized yet. And when I was back there hearing that, I was just seeing deliverance hitting everybody. You know what? Sometimes I like sitting in the back. It's very neat back there. But I was seeing the deliverance just hitting people as the Lord was depositing the season and maximizing the season. And there was a greatness and there was a thankfulness and there was a strength that was being poured into you all. I was watching the Lord. I was watching him. I was watching the Holy Spirit. So I just want to thank the Lord right now for what he's done. And I'm going to give it back to you.
What we're going to do is, I felt like there's two main groups as she was speaking. And I was just asking the Lord. I think that there's two main areas we want to just take you guys, take the limits off. You know, imagine a world where it's just as if nothing bad has ever happened to you and it's nothing bad's ever been done to you. And in the same world, you have everything that you need. God's provided that and more. I'm just limiting it for the sake of a message. But so what we're going to do is we're going to start by having anyone that you feel like you need forgiveness in an area. If that's you, just raise your hand. Just raise them high, high, high. Thank you. Hands everywhere. Thank you, Jesus. So the second group that's really important is that group that says, I need to forgive someone else. If there's someone in your heart that you know you need to forgive, can you raise your hand nice and high? Oh, awesome, awesome. Hands everywhere. One thing I love about you guys is you're so transparent. Never lose that. It's the most precious gift to God. So what we're going to do is we're going to pray together. If we could just get a song on. Actually, Jeremy, can you just come up and just play some keys, Jeremy? Nice and soft in the background. Come on. George, maybe you can help. So we're just going to pray. Lord, we thank you right now for every hand that was raised. Every hand that was raised in this place. We thank you, Father, for total forgiveness. Forgiveness in every area of our life, God. Lord, that you'd stir up a forgiving heart and a heart that's forgiven. Father, a forgiven heart is always forgiving. So remind us of the forgiveness that you've paid for, God. When there was millions and millions and trillions in debt we owed to you because our sins were many, God, you forgave. You forgave because you knew we didn't know who we were. We were lost in sin. We were gone. And Lord, I pray even those that felt like they lived good lives, Lord, there's still so much of Adam that was in us, Lord, that we don't even know. But you forgave it all. Right now, Lord, anyone that needs forgiveness, Lord, I thank you for forgiving us all of everything, every area, God. I thank you, Lord, that your mercy is new every morning. God, you never get tired of forgiving because you always know forgiveness takes us to our true identity. Sons and daughters, rise. Be forgiven and go and do the same. To all those that have been forgiven much, go and forgive much. To those who don't remember the depth of your forgiveness, reveal it now, Father, in the name of Jesus. For great is your love. And Father, break our hearts for those that don't know who they are, that have hurt us, that have given us trauma, Lord, that have given us excuses to live stuck in patterns and stuck in a season. God, we forgive them and let them go in this season because we know there's greater things beyond. We know, Lord, that when we let them go, Lord, they can go further, that they can learn who they are. So, Lord, I just thank you. Whether that means we call them up, whether it means we write them a letter, whether it means we just let them go in our hearts and we know it's not good for us to see them, whatever it is, Lord, we just release grace right now to forgive. Grace right now to release. Grace and peace right now over each mind. And we declare healing over your body. Healing over each person in this room. Lord, that their past will no longer haunt them. Their past will no longer control them. Father, we just thank you. Thank you right now in the name of Jesus. Resting on each one. The dove, Holy Spirit. Come, 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 come. Heal every wound. Heal every deep place, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that it's time to rise. It's time to shine. It's time to become who you've called us to be. And we just thank you for all these things, Lord. We thank you for the mighty blood of Jesus. We thank you for the mighty name of Jesus. We are forgiven. And because we are, we can go and do the same. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You're so good. We bless you in the name of Jesus that you go and sin no more. And if you sin, remember you have an advocate with the Father, Christ Jesus, to rise and shine again. Never let one moment define your day. And never let one day define your season or your year, that you arise and step into newness. And we just declare that over each one in this body. In Jesus' name, can you just say amen? Come on, if you just want to pray or fellowship.